Thank you. Okay, there's the mic. Good afternoon and welcome to the conclusion today's program for day three of South by Southwest EDU. It's been a blast thus far. A lot of learning has happened and we're excited for a very strong finish. A few updates before we jump into today's keynote speaker. First off, I'm Greg Rosenbaum. I'm the producer for South by Southwest EDU. It's been a real privilege to help produce and build this platform for you guys. We're really excited to have your participation here this week. thank you. Later this evening, we'll have a series of meetups about different topics within education over at the Hilton on the fourth floor. I highly encourage you to go check those out. Additionally, we'll have our Launch EDU party and winners announcement. There's been a heated competition over the last 2 days that's occurred over at the Hilton, and we'll be excited at the Palm Door on 6th Street to be announcing the winner around 8 o'clock tonight. And then finally, tomorrow, we have a really exciting morning full of sessions and workshops, and then we will conclude South by Southwest EDU for the first time ever in honor of our 5th year anniversary with a closing program that looks at education through the lens of South by Southwest music, film, and interactive. So I highly encourage you to join us for that tomorrow afternoon. So over the past few days, we've heard from some amazing speakers who are putting educators at the forefront of the conversation. From Charles Best, the teacher turned entrepreneur who created ways for teachers to raise funds for their classroom, to Elizabeth Green and David Epstein, who debated what goes into making a great instructor. Our next speaker will continue the conversation as she shares how she found a unique path to inspire creativity and marry it with hard skills required to implement. Last year, we were thrilled to screen the film If You Build It, which documents an educator's struggle and perseverance in creating a design course in rural North Carolina. The star of the film, Emily Pilloton, has since had a tremendous impact on creativity in making an education. She is the founder and executive director of Project H, which she started in 2008, and spends most of her time welding with 10-year-old girls and co-teaching Studio H. Following her remarks, there'll be a Q&A, as we've done the last 2 days, using Slido. I encourage you to go to the website and use the hashtag SXSWedu to submit your questions. I think she'll have time for a number of them following her talk, so I encourage you to do that. And then finally, there'll be a screening of If You Build It later tonight at 6:30 p.m. at the Alamo Draft House on 6th Street. So if you're inspired to come see the film, I'd love for you to come check that out. And I know Emily will be joining for that film screening as well. So without further ado, please join me in welcoming Emily Pilloton.
Awesome, thanks. Hi, I can't see any of you, but oh, there you are. Hi. Good afternoon. Thank you for coming. I know it's the end of the day. So I was standing back there, and I'm always really bad at starting talks, and I was like, oh God, what am I going to say? What am I going to say? So I thought I want to get a sense of who's in the room right now. So I'm going to do a little experiment that I've never done before. Does anyone know what a power clap is? Okay, so if you don't know what a power clap is, I'm gonna say 1, 2, 3, and everyone's gonna clap once really loud. We're gonna do it by category. So the first category is teachers. So if you're a classroom teacher, I'm gonna count 1, 2, 3, and I want you to clap once really loud. Okay, ready? Teachers, 1, 2, 3. Okay, that's a good amount. How about other school administrators that work in a school but not in the classroom? Ready? 1, 2, 3. About the same. Okay, how about someone, if you're a creative professional that happens to work in the realm of education, like a designer or anything else in that creative practice? Ready? 1, 2, 3. Okay, and then how about anything in the other category that I didn't mention? Ready? 1, 2, 3. Okay, awesome. Okay, so that was great. That's a pretty diverse crowd. So thanks for playing along. So I am a designer by training, and actually an architect by training, and I'm sort of an accidental educator. I fell into this really amazing role that I feel very lucky to get to do this kind of work. I get to practice design and architecture. I just happen to do that in a school setting with young people, and it's really, really exciting for me. So I wanted to tell a couple stories today and then leave you with some homework. I was thinking like, okay, how do I paint the picture of what Project H is and what the mission is and what I believe to be important about design. So I was thinking, okay, I'm gonna start with a couple people that very much formed who I am, taught me how to learn, made me creative, and really led to the creation of Project H. So the first is this guy. So this is MacGyver. I was in a room recently where I was like, MacGyver was my first crush, and everyone was too young and didn't know what that was, and I was like, oh no. So MacGyver, as most of you I hope know, was super hot, and he was the star of a TV show, and when I was like 5 years old, I had a huge crush on him. And the reason why, aside from the Jeep and the houseboat, was that he could get himself out of any situation with a little bit of creative thinking, albeit fictitious, but it was the first time I ever saw on TV or really anywhere this character that knew how to get himself out of anything using creative problem solving. And while at the time I didn't know to call that design or design thinking or building or whatever or innovation, it seemed really cool to me. So even at a young age, I really looked up to the character of MacGyver as a problem solver. And then secondly, these are my two grandmothers. So on the left, I'm half Chinese and half French. So on the left is my Chinese grandmother, and on the right is my French grandmother. Both of them I called Ping, because when I was 6 years old, I was like, Mom, why does everyone call their grandmother grandmother? That's so lame. I want to call my grandmothers Ping. I have no idea where that came from, but it stuck for their entire lives. So these are my two Pings. And they taught me to be strong and sassy and to never take what you're given as the ultimate solution and to ask questions about everything and challenge the reality that you're told is reality. My Chinese grandmother on the left is also holding a saw, which I often find myself holding also, but she played it as a musical instrument, which was so weird and haunting. I don't know if anyone's ever heard of a saw played as a musical instrument with a violin bow, but a really amazing thing, and I love this photo of her because I still use saws. And then thirdly, three of my teachers from high school. On the left is Miss Schrick. And she in particular, she was my honors pre-calculus teacher, junior year of high school. And she is this very sweet homemaker. She loves making cookies and she does needlepoint, but she is a hard ass in the classroom. And she was the first teacher that really pushed me and told me you can solve that problem five other ways and you only did it once. So I want to see you do it five other ways. And then also Ms. Jaime, who's in the middle, she was my economics teacher, and Mr. Cohen, who was my environmental science teacher. This photo was taken a week ago. I was brought back to the school for career day, which was super fun. And I got to reconnect with them and thank them for being amazing teachers and for teaching me how to learn, and then now also teaching me how to be a teacher. And then lastly, my two sisters, who are also in this photo. We're all 5 years apart. I'm the oldest, and they have taught me how to have fun and not take myself too seriously. And I say that in earnest. Those are very important things that I believe to be central to who I am and how I want to live my life and how I want to do my work. So all of this has manifested, I thank all of these people for turning me into a lifelong learner. And all of this has manifested in the form of a nonprofit that I founded 7 years ago called Project H Design. So I'll tell the very condensed version of how this came to be. I studied architecture. I went to graduate school for architecture. I left with $87,000 in student loans and quickly was told by my mother and a lot of other people that I better get a real job and have a 401k, start paying off my loans, and be a grown-up. It turns out I'm not very good at any of those things. So I worked for a number of different firms. I started my own furniture company. I was working in a commercial firm. I worked for this retail clothing company as their store architect and just wasn't into it. I couldn't exactly figure out why. And then one day I realized it was because all the things that I loved about architecture, all of the building and the problem solving and having to understand every core subject in an applied way and talking to people and building something real. I didn't get to do any of that in my jobs. I was mostly arguing with people about plumbing fixtures or doorknobs all day long. So I woke up one day and went into work and got stuck in this horrible meeting arguing about doorknobs. And I quit the next day and I vowed to myself that I wasn't gonna work like that anymore. And even if it meant moving in with my parents, which I did, and having very little money, which I also did, that I wanted to find a way to make design meaningful again. And I didn't know how to do that other than to start a nonprofit, to give it a name that came from like nowhere. I wrote down a bunch of words that started with the letter H, like humanity and habitats, health and happiness and hammers and heart and hands. And I was like, okay, that's gonna be my business name. So at the time, it was really, it was sort of slapped together, but it was also like a kick in the pants to say, you know what, I don't like practicing architecture this way, and I want to change it. So that was the birth of this nonprofit. And over the past 7 years, we've learned a whole lot. We've evolved, we've changed, we've reinvented ourselves 10 times over. So in 4 minutes, this is a semi-long video clip, but I'm going to show it. It's a four-minute clip. This is Project H as it is today.
There's no reason in the entire world to be bored. Project H is a nonprofit organization based in Berkeley, California. It's a magical space where craziness and creativity are encouraged. We are four architects and educators working with 200 young people in middle school and high school to apply design skills in their education and out in their community. We look at our students and see geniuses and believe that every student in our class has something amazing to contribute. When you put a tool in the hands of a young person, there's the instinct to use it in a really creative way. It's super powerful for a kid to say, "I drew this thing and now I'm building it." Studio H is an academic design and building class for middle and high school students. Students design and build architectural projects in response to something they identify as a need in their community. A student walks into Studio H, sketches something. It's rough at first, then they make it better and better and refine it into this thing they invested their own creativity and time into. Then we tell them they can take it off the paper and turn it into something real. Right now, our students are building two tiny homes on 8x16-foot trailers that they designed and detailed from models to construction documents. They're looking at the issue of housing, socially, environmentally, economically, and will be donating the homes to an organization that houses the homeless. Every day, they're outside on the job site in neon hard hats, cranking bolts, driving screws, raising walls, and creating something together in ways that most students don't always experience in school. They learn a level of precision and care just to get one simple thing right. Something like holding a screw in exactly the right place or applying enough force to drive that screw into a 2x4. Creating something as ubiquitous as a house makes you look at the things around you in a different way because now you understand how they're put together. Camp H is a building program for young girls. They learn to do all sorts of things: carpentry, masonry, electronics, and right now they're welding. Welding is such a fun thing and is superhuman. You do it once and you have this amazing skill. At first they just get comfortable with the tool itself by doing practice welds. Then they get used to the motion and the feeling of welding and get a really good sense of how their hand moves with it and how their weld is different than the next girl's. It's really powerful and necessary to give girls opportunities to do things that are unexpected. Our students have grown from kids into fearless young women. They're audacious and brave. There's nothing you could say to them that they wouldn't try, and Camp H amplifies that. Workshop H is a series of adult classes where we take some of the things that our girls do in camp and get to teach it to their mothers or their teachers or amazing women that just want to learn something new. By making something as basic as bookends, they learn the possibilities of a simple skill. They don't have to worry about whether or not they messed up or if they made the right creative choice. It's just about that weld in that moment. The best education comes from learning by doing things for other people. When students walk into our classroom, we want them to understand building as something that can empower them and also something that can affect others. We want to cultivate a sense of unwavering confidence. There's no one that can tell you you can't fuse metal, build a house, or be a scientist, or an author, or an orthodontist, or an astronaut. At Project H, we don't accept anyone saying they're bored. There's no reason in the entire world to be bored. There's always something to learn, and there's always a tool at your fingertips.
All right, so that, thanks. You're the first people to see that video publicly. So that's Project H, the end. Just kidding. So I actually want to go back to the beginning, though, because Project H itself has been this great learning process and design process in and of itself, and something that's been reinvented and prototyped. Five years ago, I got a cold call email from a superintendent in rural North Carolina. Some of you may know this story. And he sent me this email. I didn't recognize his name or the name of the town that he was from. And he said, I heard about Project H. I read about it in Dwell magazine. And I was like, what kind of superintendent reads Dwell magazine? This guy sounds cool. He's like, can you come down here and help me fix the school district that I've been assigned by the state to fix because it's about to fall apart? And he's like, we've tried everything. Everything we've tried for the past century has failed us. So I thought I'd call some architects. So I was like, OK, great. That sounds like a challenge. So he turned out to be this really amazing visionary guy. And he believed in creativity as a resource, not just for the students, but for the entire district to reimagine what they were doing and how they were serving kids. And so long story made very short, my partner Matt and I moved there. And we lived there for 2.5 years. And we worked with him very closely, first really as architects. We redesigned and rebuilt a lot of their school facilities. And then after doing that for about a year, we realized, you know, we can beat around the bush all day long, but if design's not in the classroom, then what are we really doing here? So we created this program, Studio H, which is an academic course, as you saw in the video. And this is our very first class of students. We had 10 students. They were juniors, and they were in a track of the school that was brand new and really messed up. So they would come to us for 3 hours a day, and we would teach them design and building and architecture. And the rest of their day, they were online taking classes like Spanish, English, and PE online. Think about that one. So really, like, our classroom was the only real classroom they had all day long. And we felt like, OK, here's our opportunity to really test as an experiment how far we can push design and building as a mode of operating for learning and for kids just to be growing up and understanding their own world. So this is Jamisha and Rhodey. And the project that we gave them, their big homework assignment for the whole year, was that we were going to research, design, prototype and build a full-scale piece of public architecture for the town of 1,500 people. And we had the whole school year and the summer following to do this. So the thing that they identified was a farmer's market, which in a lot of other places in the country, not so revolutionary. In rural North Carolina, very revolutionary. And it's a food desert. There's a very high poverty level, but there's also an agricultural legacy. So it made a lot of sense on a lot of levels. And we had the buy-in of the mayor. He gave us this beautiful plot of land, and he said, go build whatever those kids come up with. And I was like, that's an amazing mayor. So we did like what felt like 1,500 architecture models. We went and visited a lot of other farmers markets. We analyzed them. We looked at precedents of different types of architectural taxonomies. We presented ideas to the town, and this is my student Karan showing his first design to this guy named Jock, who was one of the town councilmen at the time. And this photo is one of my favorites because these two people never would have met if it hadn't been for this project, and I say that with like total certainty. They're in this room and they're talking about this project that both of them like were just dying to make happen for very different reasons. But they were in it together, and they were both totally invested. And so this was the first time when I looked at this photo after I took it, I thought, like, OK, we're onto something here. This is why design matters. So I'm not going to show the entire school year because it was crazy and long. But by the end of the school year, we realized, OK, we've designed this thing, and like now we actually have to build it, which when I was in architecture school, you design something and you put it on a table and some critics come in and maybe make you cry and tell you it sucks or tell you they love it and like that's it. And you go home and that's it. So I also wanted to prove to my students that like you can build the thing that you design. It doesn't have to stop as this idea on a page. So we had 3 months, we had $60,000, we had we had to engineer this thing to hurricane and flood zone constraints, so 110 mile an hour winds. We had a construction crew of teenagers. It was 110 degrees outside. And if you're under the age of 18 on a construction site in North Carolina, you can't operate a power tool. So these are like our real world constraints. And for all the work we did in the classroom, like this is really where the rubber hits the road. We have to figure out how to build this thing. And we had it all engineered. We worked out all the calculations. And even with all of that preparation, the minute you hit the construction site, it's a whole different ball game. So we dug a lot of holes and we poured a lot of concrete. We pre-built these giant trusses inside the classroom and then had to disassemble all 27 2x12s that were coated, move them to the construction site in like 4 pickup trucks, reassemble them with mallets because we couldn't use power tools, and then raise them into place. I had to learn how to operate that machine in about 30 seconds. So I was learning as well. and then back to basics of like care and precision and basic carpentry, that if I need a piece that's 85 and 5/8, I don't want one at 85 and a half. You're going to have to recut it, and that cost us $22. So like Jamisha and Karan here, like taking such great care and time and precision, not just because I was telling them to, but because this is something that started on their desk. It started as a model that they all worked on together, and now it's bigger than they are. Putting up the siding, this would eventually become like sort of a billboard for the town that they could advertise as like, this is Windsor, and something that became a real landmark for the town. And this is the final structure when it was done. If you want to see the inside story of like when I threw out my back and when I went home crying every day and all the like, you know, interesting parts of the story, I definitely encourage you to see the film. It's showing tonight at 6:30. This was a really amazing year for all of us involved, and it was proof in my mind that we were onto something, and there was a whole level of design, building, and leadership that could happen that I wasn't seeing in schools. So at the opening ceremony of this farmers market, these are some of the students at the opening ceremony. The mayor gave them the key to the city, which was very cute. And then Karan, who's there in his striped shirt, got up and said, I'm 17. I didn't think I would be able to do this. And now I know I want to come back here someday with my kids and tell them that I built this. And so that was like this big light bulb moment for me, that was why all of this mattered, that was the power of design. And so this first year, I mean, we were all kind of in foreign territory, and I wanted to use it as like proof that we could push for this type of education for all kids. So I'm just gonna show, I'm sorry to bombard you with video content, but I'm gonna show the trailer for the film. It's a really great story. It's mostly about these students, and you see them become young adults over the course of this film, so I definitely encourage you to see it tonight.
Bertie County is a prime example in the demise of rural America.
I'm not leaving because I won't leave. I'm leaving because there's nothing to keep me here.
There's not a whole lot of opportunities for our kids here.
I mean, school, I hate it. My dad hated it. My granddaddy hated it. I'm carrying on a tradition.
We have kids coming through that door any minute.
What if you could bring back shop class, but orient the projects around things that the community needed?
So here's the challenge.
We have one full year to build a community project.
Is this what we're gonna be doing all year? Give me a zero. You gotta be out your mind.
All right, let's get to work.
It's not a typical class. We don't have a desk. It's crazy.
What I hope to see in 16 weeks is that little model full size.
We're making something for the town of Windsor, so we have to make it right.
We're raising the clock.
Throw that stuff away. There's nails sticking up. All I'm asking is that you do a halfway decent job.
So at the end of this little pep talk?
The pressure's on now.
Our offered salaries have been taken off the table.
Bertie County has never paid him a dime.
We're at our absolute limits.
I'm not having this discussion.
Everything just fell apart.
Yes, it does have to be perfect.
We just decided that something had to give.
It's bigger than the students. It's bigger than their education. At this point, it's the town's.
They're trying to teach us how to look outside the box.
Why? Why is something the way it is?
Make something better out of everything.
Are the things you're doing making a difference in anyone's lives?
I think it's critical that people rally around this thing.
I just want these kids to be excited about coming to school every day.
Right. It's just amazing.
You always need to keep putting ideas together to make a better one.
I've never been a part of something so big.
Breakthrough moments happen so rarely that half the time you think you're just doing a lousy job as a teacher. But when it does happen, I mean, it just floors you.
The farmer's market is the beginning.
To stand here and look around, it's just amazing.
It really was a blessing.
I love those guys.
I'm so proud of them.
This is something that really can transform lives.
It's a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity, and it happened to us.
So I get really emotional watching that. So we left Bertie County after 2.5 years, and that is a whole other presentation. And you'll see some of why we left in the film. But we left, and when we left, our students, and beyond, our students have gone on to do really amazing things. They are in college. A lot of them are the first in their families to go to college. Some of them are employed locally. One of the students has since come back and is now the manager of the farmer's market. The farmer's market created 4 new businesses and 15 jobs, which is 3 times as much growth as the whole town saw in 2 years. And we left on sort of a bittersweet note, but we moved our program to Berkeley, California. And we did that for a number of reasons. I'm from the Bay Area and I wanted to come home. But also because I felt like we had a little bit of proof that there was something to this model, but I wanted to test it at the other end of the spectrum, at the other extreme. Like I said, this has been a design process for us also, and we want to test things and prototype them and change them at all ends of the spectrum. So we moved to this school in Berkeley called Realm Charter School. It's the only charter school in Berkeley. And when we joined Realm, it was only their second year of operation. So we also came to Realm thinking, like, this is going to be so awesome. We get to shape the entire culture of the school. And we have been able to do that. So that's very exciting also. We have almost 270 students that are in the Studio H class right now, and they're 6th to 12th graders. We've also expanded grade levels. But Realm is really where I came to understand both the limits and the possibilities of what this looks like in an urban charter school that has, on one hand, more resources, and on the other is much more tightly constrained. But I think this is also where we as an organization came to understand how design looks in a very tight classroom with 200 students and what it looks like when you try to take it to scale. So this is Agustina, and she is a 9th grader. She's like my hero. I love her. She's one of my favorite students, and not because she's the best student. She's in our Studio H class, and I've known her for a couple years now, and she's grown into this like amazing girl and leader, and I can say with some confidence that a lot of that has been because of Studio H. This year, Agustina and her 87 classmates are working on these tiny home projects, these two tiny homes. And Agustina has become a real leader, both in her class period and then over the entire program, to rally students, to get out there, to put their hard hat on, and to make this thing a reality. So just like with the farmers market, we started with the research and with the prototyping and trying to figure out some of the bigger issues around housing that is such a personal thing. Like, everyone knows what a safe home feels like. But then at a very big level, in a city like Berkeley, there are huge social and economic and environmental pressures around the issue of housing. So we wanted them to be able to personalize it and then also look at it as something that we can do to have a conversation with a bigger community. So Agustina and her classmates made hundreds and hundreds of models. They looked at different precedents of housing that were both local, around the world, in different materials, different types of space, different types of engineering. And then they shared them with each other. And they were very honest, as teenagers are, around the things that they liked, the things that they knew they wanted their house to have. A number of them really wanted a hot tub. And I said, I had to veto that one. I said, we'll save that for the Cribs edition. And again, they didn't know that reference, so I was like, I give up. So what we ended up with over many days of critique was a very simple shed roof structure, and we're actually building two of them. So they're mirror images of each other, kind of like a BFF heart necklace where you give your friend the other half. So they're like little Siamese twins, and we're building them as mirror images, and one will be donated to this organization that houses the homeless for 6 months and then places them in jobs. And then the other will be auctioned off, and that's so that we can continue to do this project. So just like with the farmer's market, that rendering is all well and good and it's beautiful, but now we have to build the thing. And so that's what we're doing right now, and probably what my students are working on at this moment. So we have to figure out like really annoying little things, like not just the framing plan for the walls, but what order does every single stud need to be put in such that when we install the windows, everything's perfect? Or where do we need to use screws versus nails? Or what are the calculations on the seismic frame so that everything's tied down really well? So these are all things we had to think through, and we had to apply math and science and all the things they're learning in other classes to make this thing stand up. We also had to, you know, get the trailers. We did a whole sponsorship packet. There was this big level of entrepreneurship where we had students that had to make calls and say, hi, I'm a student at Realm Charter School, and I'm in this program, and we're wondering if you could cut us a deal on trailers. And like that's a hard thing for a teenager to do. That's a hard thing for me to pick up the phone and do, but it's a part of the process, and it's all these little things to make something real. So the trailer, both of the trailers, we had to frame out. There's these seismic tie downs, so everything is bolted in place. Insulation, waterproofing, rodent proofing, subflooring. Augustina again became one of the site foremen for women. She was like bossing people around in the very nice way that she does it. For all of the framing plans, she was in charge of the Bible, the framing plan Bible. And then all of the walls started to go up. And this is like my favorite part of any architecture project, that all of a sudden, I wish I had video of all of my students' faces the minute the first wall goes up. It's like this, oh my God, it's a house. It's not just a model on my desk, and it's bigger than I am. So this is the day when we got all the walls up on the first house. And then this is taken just the other day, right before I got on a plane to come here. This is the state of the houses now. They're being sheathed. They're starting to take shape. They put in windows today. So these will be done by June. And this was a lot of this. I mean, every single student had a say in it. But I mentioned Augustina in particular because of how much she's grown and because of how she really rose to the occasion and has become one of the leaders on the job site. Augustina also, because she's been such a leader, she volunteered to help out with our younger girls camp. So not just a leader in the classroom, but a mentor to younger girls. So Camp H, as you saw in the video, is this building camp for younger girls. They're ages 9 to 12. They're very, very cute. It's also very hard to find safety equipment for 10-year-old girls. So this is Augustina helping one of our camper girls learn how to cut and measure wood and build a scale model. So she's giving back to the girls who are younger than she is. One of the girls who Augustina mentored is this little girl named Erica, who here she's using a brad nailer for the first time. And I hate that I put this photo in here because my hair should be tied back, and I know that, for anyone that wanted to call me out on that. So Erica was one of the girls that Augustina mentored, and the two of them kind of just like took to each other as these kindred spirits. And Erica came to us as a 9-year-old, and she was very shy, and she loved math, but she was afraid to say it, and she doesn't really play sports, and she doesn't really play music, but you could tell she was just so brilliant and hadn't found the thing that really lit her up. So she came to us, and I put a brad nailer in her hand, and she built this little birdhouse. This is the first thing that she ever built. She had to make some creative choices about, you know, where, like, I was like, be the bird. So where do you want the little roosting box to be? Where do you want to perch? Like, what color do you want it to be? Where should it hang? So all the girls made different choices about those things, and these are some of the other bird houses. So we start really small, and it's really just about building confidence and building skills with tools that pretty much none of them had used or possibly even seen. Next, I taught Erica how to weld. She's now like a way better welder than I am, but she's 9 in this picture. And she learned basic MIG welding, which all the girls learn in the first couple hours that they're with us in camp. And I don't, for anyone here who knows how to weld, you know how it does feel like kind of like a superpower. Like you're fusing metal, you're basically holding a lightning bolt. So for a 10-year-old girl, you can imagine how scary slash awesome this is. Also because the welding helmets often don't fit them. They're just too big, so I have to like awkwardly hold it while she's welding. But they walk out of camp on this day in particular as different people. They walk out with like a little swagger, like I just fused metal. What are you gonna tell me I can't do right now? So the first challenge with the steel, similar to the birdhouse, was just about small creative choices. That I said to them, okay, you have four pieces of steel, and they are either trapezoids or parallelograms. Everything was cut at a 45 degree angle. And I said, you need to research the meaning of your name and create a graphic symbol that represents it. So that's like a kind of cerebral task in and of itself. And then they have to figure out how to do that in steel. So this is Erica's symbol. Her middle name is Noelle, and so Erica means royal, I guess, and Noelle means Christmas or birthday. So she made this thing that was supposed to represent a candle and a celebration, and she named it the Confetti Kingdom. So again, like something that's really personal to her, that she put a lot of her own love and time and care into, but it was made with this pretty badass tool. And she walked out that day feeling like a different person. So then we have all these, you know, all these amazing girls who have a little bit of knowledge using these tools, and then we say to them, okay, you know how to use these things individually. Now it's time to use them collaboratively and to look outside ourselves and to look down the street or into our community and ask ourselves how we can use these skills for the benefit of someone else. So down the block from where our camp is located is this amazing women's shelter that we've worked with on a couple of occasions. And actually last summer, one of our camper girls lived in the women's shelter with her mother. And so she came to camp and we started talking about the women's shelter and we said, you know what, that like we want to work with them. We want them to be both our client and our co-designers. So these are the projects that the girls came up with. This is one, you can kind of see it. It says Fearless in steel. So they welded this sign together that says Fearless. It was spray painted bright pink and given to the women's shelter. And then Erica was part of the team that designed and built a small playhouse. I think because one of our campers, this little girl, Amber, she lived there. And she said, you know, we don't really have like a playground or any play space. So they designed and built this playhouse for the children that were living there. This is, they're using the chop saw and the table saw. And then this is you can barely see the playhouse because they're like all over it. But it was very cute. And we physically delivered it there. And it was a really, really special moment for them. And for a minute, I was thinking, like, are they going to be mad that they don't get to take something home and show it to their parents? Like, I made this. I'm so proud of it. None of them said that once. They seemed to be so much more excited about doing something for other people, which I thought was really, really special. And then just last week, we finished our winter camp session, and Erica was the first girl to earn all of her skill badges. So there's carpentry, welding, masonry, electronics, fix-it, graphics, leadership, service, thesis, and architecture and design, which are actually not in this photo. But she was the first girl to earn all of them, and she was so excited, and one of her her fellow campers was like, wait, what about Tia? I thought Tia had all of hers. And Erica goes, no, she does not have the thesis badge. So she'd been tracking everyone else. So she was the first one to earn all these badges, and she's about to age out of the camp. And so I was like, God, how do I keep working with this girl? She's so amazing, and she's so creative, and she still doesn't even know how creative and brilliant she is. So I asked her to join our workshop program as a co-instructor. So Augustina taught Erica. Erica is now teaching as part of our adult program. So this is Erica teaching an adult woman how to polish steel. She helped me. She was standing right next to me. This is her doing a demo weld with eight women. We did a women's welding and wine workshop in that order, welding and then wine. Erica left before the wine was served. So she was able to be in a position of expertise for these grown women. Like, let me show you how to use this thing that I know how to use really well. So we've run three different workshops now and a number of really wonderful women, some of whom are mothers of campers, some of whom are teachers, some of whom came from across the country and like spent the weekend in the Bay Area and came out and learned how to weld. And one of the women who came to our most recent workshop was Miss Schrick, who was my pre-calculus teacher. And she came and she showed up and she of course brought cookies and like made this little name tag for me and she's like, I'm here to learn how to weld. She's very like, and she learned how to weld and she's an amazing welder and Erica taught her how to weld. So this is, and it wasn't until I was putting together this presentation that I was thinking like, that is also what's really special about design. That there are, it's a level playing field, that all of these women and all of my students come in, and it doesn't matter whether they're failing math, it doesn't matter whether they're living below the poverty line, it doesn't matter what race or gender or grade level or age even that they are all in a creative space, and we rise together, and we problem solve together, and we fail together, and it's a really special and important space for learning because of those things. So I want to give you some homework because I was thinking like what can I leave as like a challenge for everyone who's in this room who, in a way, I'm sort of preaching to the choir. I feel like everyone in here already feels like creativity is pretty darn important. But where we get hung up is well, how do we actually do it? How do we practice it? The three big things that I've learned from this type of teaching and this type of classroom is that the first thing is that, as I said, design is a great equalizer, that it's approachable for every person, and every person will consistently and constantly be challenged by a creative design practice. The second is that in the past 7 years, I feel like I've learned a lot more than I've taught. And that there's a blurred line between who the teacher is and who the student is. And we're all teachers and we're all students. And so I try to remember that. And then the third thing, and this is kind of specific to architecture, but could be true of a lot of different media as well, that when young people, or really anyone, when we build things that are bigger than ourselves, whether it's a farmer's market or we compose an orchestra, things that are bigger than just one person, it makes us better people, and it transforms, and it can change the entire trajectory of a life. And I say that with like specific evidence of students who I can point to and say like that changed their life. And I'm so proud of them for that and for sticking through the very rigorous and difficult task of something so big and creative. So I have three homework assignments for you. The first one is really simple. I mean, a lot of people will ask me like, you have a great shop space. Like, we don't, like, what do I do? I have a math classroom, or you know, I have a garage in my house, but it's filled with junk. Make the physical space for making things, even if it's like a corner of your room or a janitor's closet. I've seen maker spaces that were put together by PTAs for like $300, and it's literally like a 6x6 room. But when you create the space, stuff will get made. So make the space for making things, and then also fill it with as many tools as you can, whether it's like a hammer or something on the super high tech side, or maybe something you don't even know how to use. I love bringing tools into my shop where I'm like, you guys, I have no idea how to use this. Like, let's grab a highlighter and go through the whole instructional manual and figure it out. So make the space, make things yourself, make things to discover things about yourself and then be able to teach them, and fill it with as many tools as possible. So that's the first assignment. The second is to wear your failures like badges of honor. So I really want to, if anyone wants to start a conference with me that is all about the biggest failures we've ever had, come and talk to me. I really want to give a presentation sometime that's just like, these are the biggest flops. These are the things that I did horribly wrong. And I'm proud of those things because I now know why they were failures. And I wouldn't have been able to work with the young people I work with now if I hadn't had those failures. So the next time you find yourself like talking to someone like, oh yeah, and then we did this and I'm really proud of this, like maybe also throw in something that you totally failed on and like, why is that important? That's, people want to hear those stories. I think people are drawn to those stories. So share those stories. One example I want to mention of this is we have about like 100 or so lesson plans, projects, readings, and other resources that we put online on our website under this toolbox. And anyone can take them and use them. And some of them, like I don't say which ones were horrible failures, but some of them were. And some of them were not, but they're all out there, and that's what's important, that we're sharing everything that we've done, and I want to encourage people to take the things that we've done and maybe totally failed at and to do them better. And then the last thing, I try to do this every day. Walk into your school or a school or any school for that matter, or your place of business or your office or anywhere, and consider yourself as a student first. So I've started doing this past year. Whenever I walk into my classroom, I say out loud, hopefully in like a non-creepy way, I say, I'm here to learn. And when I say that out loud, it just like changes something in my mind, and it puts me in the mindset of like, there are students who I'm here to teach, but they're also here to teach me something. So that's all I have. I just want to end with just a thought that I also never know how to close talks. But I feel very, very lucky. And I think that all of us in this room, I hope all of us in this room feel that same way, that we are in this moment where there's so many great things happening in education. And I'm so sick of people saying like, oh, education's broken. That you could argue that point, but like look at all of us in this room and look at all these amazing solutions that you're probably all talking about. And I see it in a kind of a different way, that it's not broken, that there is just a lot of work to do, and there's a lot of creative work to do, and that's exciting for me. So I feel really lucky to do the work that I do. I think creativity and design, whether you're trained as a designer or not, creativity is a common language, and it's a way of being, and it's really powerful for kids, and it's really powerful for all of us in this room, that at its very most basic level, it's just a constant belief that everything can be better, and knowing that you have the tools to make it that way. Thank you. Okay, so I have this digital question. All right, so I'm gonna just fire away. And I wish I knew who asked these questions. Okay, the first one is, is there Studio H curriculum available for school districts nationwide? So this is, I knew I was gonna get this question. I would say yes and no. So I went and saw the film Most Likely to Succeed last night. Did any other people there? It was amazing. And they were saying something at the very end that really like struck a chord with me, that up until this point, education has been a pretty industrialized and standardized system, and yet it's a human endeavor. And so I'm answering this in a roundabout way, but I feel very strongly that the amazing things that we do to serve kids in schools are always in response to a context, just like as an architect, I think a building should be in response to a context. So on one hand, I wanna make our curriculum available to everyone and anyone, and that's why we've put it all out on our toolbox to just say like, here, go take it. Like, I will give anyone in this room my hard drive and you can go and do your thing. But I also feel really strongly that people put in the time and effort to make things contextually appropriate and to make them meaningful to the kids they have in their school, in that place, in that time. So yes, the toolbox is all open source. Yes, we've done coaching and workshops for specific districts to try to create their own version of Studio H. There's a school in San Francisco right now that's launching their own design program that is almost exactly Studio H, but under a different name. But there's nothing that I can like pull out of my back pocket and just give to you, and that's on purpose. This is really awkward. I feel like I'm answering to no one. Okay, what is the kid's first reaction when they are required to do manual work? Especially nowadays when almost everything is digital, do you see big differences? Okay, I love this question. Okay, so I am known as a Luddite. Some of my students call me Ron Swanson. I don't like really high-tech stuff, that's just me. But it's interesting that I have kids who are like, you know, 10 to 17, and they grew up on a screen. And so a part of me is like, okay, they're not gonna be into all of this analog stuff, but it's amazing how much they are. And I think there's, some of them are actually really hungry for it. I think when they have to do something that's like physically in their hands that doesn't work right, where like this doesn't fit with that, and you have to wrangle with all these things that you don't have to deal with on a screen, it's a lot of the same mental capacity. Like the kids that play Minecraft, they bring that same kind of like problem-solving, tinkery mentality, but it's just a different medium. So that being said, though, we have a table saw right next to a laser cutter. So it's not that I'm like anti-technology. I feel like it's more important for a student to understand the why of what they're doing, and what the big idea is, and then be able to choose from a whole array of tools rather than walk in and say, like, today I'm learning laser cutter. That's not the point. So, okay, next. While students like Erica are success stories, do you find that there are kids who are not so successful in these environments? Do they stay in the program? Absolutely. So that's like the failure talk I want to give. I mean, there are a lot of students that, not a lot, but there's always a handful of students that just aren't into it. Some of them were able to sway, like Jamisha, who you saw in the trailer, who was like, give me a zero, I don't want to be here. She came around, and a lot of it is just once you build something and you look at it, you're like, oh, okay, I get it now. Like, I get it. I want to do more of that. Other students, and this is more true now that we're in Berkeley, we have a number of students who, and I'm not trying to pass the buck, but I do think there are a lot of students that come to our school in particular that have, they're just up against some things that like no class can really change in the immediate future. I mean, we have our students for 55 minutes a day. There are students that have things going on in their lives that no 17-year-old should be dealing with ever, and yet they are. And so we work with them on a very personal level to try to weed through some of that and give them different kinds of challenges. But there are a handful of kids that just either don't want to stay, or it's just not their thing. So, and I get that too. There should be a level of choice. This question, I jokingly said to the tech guys, I'm like, oh, if you want to throw this one in, the question is, what's your spirit animal? And they did put it in. So my spirit animal is a tiger, because I'm half Chinese, and my mother was sort of a tiger mom, but I love her for it. And tigers are a symbol of both power and grace. And they're really cool, and every time I see them at the zoo, I want to bear hug them. Thanks for throwing that one in. Okay, and then I'm gonna do two more. So did you ever think about not doing it, parentheses, starting Project H? What made you go forward? What kept you going when you had doubts? I don't know that it was really a choice. I just kind of woke up one day and was like, I hate having a boss and I hate doing this kind of work. And so it seemed like the only way to move forward. So I don't think I ever doubted it. And even now, I have moments where I'm like, I want to throw it all away and open an animal shelter. But I don't. I have like a lot of other things that are interesting to me. But I know at the end of the day that I'm very lucky to do what I do. And it's been 7 years, and I'm not going anywhere anytime soon. So okay, and then let me just see what else is left. What were your biggest challenges from the beginning to now? And what advice would you give others trying to do the same in their schools? Yeah, I mean, challenges, luckily I love challenges, and I think that's what makes my work really interesting. Certainly one of the biggest challenges, as everyone in this room probably knows, is funding. And not that that's a, actually, can you put the questions back up? I wanna end on a great one. I would say definitely funding, it's like a constant money from different sources. One of the biggest challenges I've had personally is just like learning how to be a teacher. I'm not trained as a teacher. There are so many amazing things that teachers do that I'm like, that was magic. How did you do that? So I think just bringing designers and other architects into our organization and then being really humble and saying like, look, we're not teachers. We're not. So we have a lot to learn here. And building out a staff that is like both humble and empathetic, and then also really like hardcore about the thing that they do well. I think those would probably be the biggest two. What advice would you give to others trying to do the same in their schools? Just keep doing it. Like there have been moments where it would have been really easy to just stop, but we pushed really, really, really hard, and we never took no for an answer when people said, like as you'll see in the film if you go see it, the school board in North Carolina, they were horrible to us, and they I got hate mail from them. I got like phone calls at 6 a.m. of like a school board member just cursing at me, telling me to go back to California. We had a petition of 300 signatures asking us to stay, and they ripped it up right in front of us. So I think the other piece of advice is like, don't get distracted by the haters and focus on the students. Like I try to remind myself of that every day, that like these five people are making my life miserable, but my kids are really happy and we're building something amazing. So I think the less we focus on our own petty adult things and focus on the learning of children, the better off we are. Okay, I'm trying to find a really great one to end on. Do you see that student? How do you demand precision and care from students without quashing their confidence? Okay. You ask them to do something 100 times. So with the tiny homes project, when we started building models, I said, and I say this with every project, like you're gonna build 100 models, and every single face in the classroom goes like this. But then they make 100 models. And if they only make 70, like that's still 70 models, and that's still 69 more than they would have made. So I think precision and care a lot of the time is just about sheer production. Like just do something over and over. It's no different than like playing soccer or practicing a musical instrument. If you do something enough times and you're critical enough and honest enough with yourself to say like, that was okay, I'm gonna change this next time. You do something 100 times, your 100th one is gonna be pretty darn good. So I think it's less about like quashing their confidence and just saying like, that's awesome, do another one, do another one, do 10 more, do 100 more, yeah. So I hope that you will be able to join us for the film. I'll be there for a Q&A afterwards, and thank you so much for coming out. Thanks.